Hello, my name is Michaela Brouette, and I'm a senior at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, where I'm majoring in psychology and elementary education. Today, the goal is to dive deep and potentially answer the question, is internet addiction real? And if it is, how widespread is it? Essentially, we are looking to see if internet addiction is a disorder, and if it is, how many people is it potentially affecting? Throughout this video a couple times, you may hear me reference the course, The Psychological Effects of the Internet. It is the main reason why I'm making this video today. It is the course I've been taking this summer at the University of Wisconsin-Madison and where I'm getting my background knowledge on this topic before I did my extra research. Regardless of the reason why you are watching this video, I do hope that you will learn a lot and that you enjoy, and I thank you for watching. So we have this question, is internet addiction real? And through this video, you'll kind of learn that it's either that internet, people are addicted to internet as a whole, or they're addicted to activities on the internet. So it's not really like a clear-cut answer. And it's a controversial argument between those two things that I described. And the research will kind of show that there's more towards the latter, that the internet is a medium and we're addicted to things, activities on the internet like gambling, shopping, cyber relationships, pornography, stuff like that. And kind of where I want to start with this background information that I started with was from the Unit 13 lecture from my professor in the course of Psychological Effects of the Internet. Professor Gernsbacher explained that, you know, dating back almost a century ago or more, that we thought we were addicted to things like reading novels, playing chess, watching the television, listening to the radio, reading the newspaper. These things that were the greatest inventions and that everybody was doing. And it's kind of like the internet as well. We all have access to it via our smartphones, tablets, computers, and it almost seems like everybody is on the internet. Everybody has access. They don't, but it seems like the majority of the population does. And with these things in the past, like watching the television, reading the newspaper, listening to the radio, we really thought that people were addicted and there was negative side effects, just like we do with the internet. And it turns out there wasn't an addiction. We weren't addicted to these things. It was the thing that was in and the thing that everybody had access to and everybody liked doing and was just consumed in. Just like the internet. And so this is where we have these two sides. In this lecture, professor talked about how the internet, using her research that she found, that the internet is a medium and that we are addicted to activities on the internet. And that is what most of the research is showing, that we are addicted to these activities on the internet. But there is a opposing side with some very, very convincing research that we are addicted to the internet as a whole. Just people can be addicted to the internet as a whole. It's just a smaller population. Going back to Professor's article and the research that she brought and the side that she presented, that we are addicted to different subtypes is what they're considered. These things already exist in society. There is already gambling addictions, shopping addictions, sex addictions, pornography addictions, relationship addictions, stuff like that. And now we just have another medium, the internet, where these are taking place. And so first I want to kind of focus on the side that has a lot of less information. That internet, we are addicted to the internet. People are addicted to the internet as a whole. After doing all this research, I don't know which side I stand on. Both of them are very convincing, no matter the amount of research there is. So let's get started with that. So here's where we're going to start. Black and Shaw in 2012 explained that internet addiction is indeed real because people have excessive or poorly controlled preoccupations, urges, and behaviors regarding internet usage that leads to impairment, distress. And they're talking about the internet usage as a whole. People have a hard time getting off the internet, and it does cause them serious impairments and distress to their life, which follows the definition of an addiction. And essentially what they're saying is that because this people are having disruptions to their everyday life because they cannot get off the internet addiction, they're not addicted to something like gambling or pornography. It's just the addiction of the internet as a whole, and it's not something just set in stone. That internet addiction is real in that sense. And Dr. Robert Poling, 2017, agrees and kind of backs this up with his research, because first he categorizes internet addiction under a behavioral addiction, claiming that people can come dependent upon the internet as a whole and have problematic use, which causes distress and impairment when they are unable to access the internet to meet their dependent needs. And their dependent needs aren't on just gambling or shopping or pornography or relationships. It's just being on the internet and being consumed in the internet in some sort of way. And other researchers that do also back up this topic include, and so now we're going to switch over and look at the other side, that the internet is a medium and that we are addicted to certain activities on the internet. And before I get started, I want to apologize for any last names I am going to butcher, because I know for a fact that I probably will not pronounce most of them right. And I do apologize for that. However, so starting out in 2014, Maria Konnikova explained in her post in the New Yorker that Mark Potenza, a psychiatrist at Yale, explained that addictions are classified into two different types, substance or behavioral. And substance are like heroin, drugs, alcohol, and behaviorals like gambling, sex, shopping. Those are like kind of the differences. And she explained that Potenza shared that internet addiction is a lot more complicated and different. It is not a typical behavioral addiction. And why? And it's because the internet is a medium, it's not an activity. And so Potenza classified five different subtypes of internet addiction. The same ones that the Addiction Center, No Date, DLE, and Olatokun 2013, and Chang and Lee in 2014 described. These five subtypes are cybersex addiction, net compulsion, cyber relationship addiction, compulsive information seeking, and computing or gaming addiction. And so kind of why is it this over internet addiction as a whole? So Dr. Matthew Kruger, who is a neuropsychologist and the director of learning and development center at the Child Mind Institute, explained that with addiction, you normally have a chemical change which leads us to be reliant on it for a level of functioning. And that's one with substance abuses, substance addictions. However, we aren't seeing that with internet addiction as a whole or internet addiction at all. We don't develop higher levels of tolerance. We don't need more screen time. We don't need to up the amount of time we're spending on the internet for dysfunction, which is getting rid of the fact that internet addiction is a substance addiction, and that if it's any type of addiction, it has to be behavioral. However, going back into Konnikova's post, where she's talking about Potenza's research, Potenza explained that with internet usage as a whole, it can't really be a behavioral addiction because we aren't seeing any of these rewards like receiving money or clothing or arousal, which activates the reward system in our brains like internet that like behavioral addictions do. And so these two research things that I talked about point us in the direction that if there's any addiction regarding internet, it has to be with the internet as a medium, not as a whole. Because the scientific basis in terms of neuropsychology that and the brain with addictions, we aren't seeing that with what would be internet addiction as a whole. It can't be a behavioral or substance addiction because it doesn't match up. It couldn't be classified fully in the DSM-5. And so continuing forward, Chang and Lee in 2014 explained that they found that people are tending to become addicted to a certain thing on the internet, which acts as a trigger for that excessive use that we're seeing, which truly isn't an addiction of the internet, it's just an addiction that's taking place on the internet. And this is just reiterating that the internet is a medium for addictions. And so now I want to go into DLE and Olatokun in 2013, and they made a really convincing statement to conclude their research that the majority of addicts are addicts on the internet rather than addicts of the internet. However, there's that rather than that there is potential that people are addicts of the internet, but most of the time they're going to be addicts on the internet, fulfilling these different these five subtypes that are explained. And so they concluded this because they found that in the study, the online addictive actions were mainly extrinsically influenced, and there was very few that had intrinsic reasoning. The majority of the participants were adolescents, were using the internet for important matters, such as sex, things that were sexual-orientated, making money or things like that, rather than just to be on it for, like, their own, like, there was that reasoning, and it was activating the reward system, like we found, that I talked about earlier, which makes the behavioral addiction, but being on the internet doesn't do that, it's the activities taking place on it. And so, like I explained, the research leaves this little room to conclude that there is the potential that people can be addicted to the internet, rather on the internet, however, that's a lot less common. And so when I start going into prevalence here, we're gonna see that. Now we're on to the prevalence. I first want to start with that the prevalence of addiction of the internet, not addictions on the internet, addiction of the internet, the one that doesn't have a lot of research supporting it. As Yellow Lesson Marks 2005 explained, and as I've mentioned, there's a lot more evidence supporting addictions of the internet rather than addiction on the internet. And as a result, there's a lot less information and research about the prevalence of this type of addiction. And, however, Shaw and Block estimated that there's less than 1% prevalence in the United States of addiction of the internet. And Adeli and Olatakan in 2013 found that internet addiction has a prevalence rate of 3.3%. But the significant majority of that percentage of university students was addictions on the internet rather than of the internet. And so almost you can assume that that percentage of the internet is going to be less than 1%. And Dr. Robert Poley, 2017, explained that prevalence rates of internet addiction, if you remember before, he supported of the internet, not on the internet, and they can be estimated to about 2%. However, this prevalence rate is just so widely varied because there's not a lot of research and they don't really know. And so now we're going to transition to the prevalence of the five subtypes, these subtypes that are addictions on the internet. And these subtypes exist as addictions outside of the internet. Gambling, shopping, love, sex, money, all of that existed before the internet. And the internet has allowed them to become cheaper and more accessible and more widely used. And so with learning this, I predicted that I would find them to be quite prevalent in our society. And so first, we're going to start with the net compulsions addiction. So net compulsions, groups addictions such as gambling, trading stocks, online shopping, online auctions such as eBay, and these addictions now being able to take place online can be a lot more dangerous, tech addiction NoDate explains. Tech addiction also explains that it's a lot easier to hide, it's a lot easier to get access, it's harder to avoid because internet access is everywhere, it's easier to get the money with online banking, and it's easier to lose track of online money. Online gambling and gaming, online gambling has the ability to addict people with like free trials, and then they're addicted, so now they spend the money. And it's easier to start at a younger age, because like with casinos, you have to be a certain age, but with online gambling, sometimes it's a lot easier to get past those restrictions, if they have them even in place. And then, so therefore, you can almost assume or expect it to be more prevalent than it is not online. Or in person. And the tech addiction was focusing on gambling. That was the main focus, but it holds true for all of the net compulsions that are in that group. And Jurgensen, 2015, explains the substance abuse and medical health services estimates 1.5 million Americans have had a gambling disorder. Imagine how much online access can add to that. And that's both online in-person gambling disorders. And online shopping is another one of those net compulsions. The Recovery Village, medically reviewed by Prolix in 2020, explained that there's a similar prevalence as in-person compulsive shopping at about 5 to 8%. So it kind of varies, but the prevalence is similar. And now on to cyber sex addiction. Florando and Cashmall 2017 found that the college population may be one of the populations that is at heightened risk for cyber sex addictions. They found that 10.3% of the college population scored in the clinical range for cyber sex addiction. They found that males were more likely to score in the clinical range as well over females. And their research was supported widely across the board from what I was looking at, and that depending on the age group, the gender, just different dynamics of the human determines the prevalence of that cyber sex addiction. Those who are single, those who have been without a partner for a longer time, those who are in the college population, more older adolescents, stuff like that, plays a big role, males over females, plays a big role in the prevalence of cyber sex addiction. With cyber sex addiction, Geralt ETL 2016 explained that it is a very easily addictive behavior. Humans are naturally sexual beings, and a good majority of people, ages teens till death, are at great risk for cyber sex death, being like 100 or plus, or just as long as we live, are at great risk for cyber sex addiction, especially those with certain demographics, as I explained before. So now on to gaming addiction, which is video games, computer games, phone games, etc. Addictions to those platforms. The research I was finding on this was more based on Asian descent rather than the U.S. population, the worldwide population. However, that does not mean it can correlate. Wang ETL 2014 found that 1 in 6 of their Hong Kong adolescents that they studied fell under the category to have video game and internet gaming addiction. In addition, they found that males are more likely to be addicted over females, most likely because males find interest in gaming over females. It's just what the statistics show and just how females are most likely to find pleasure in shopping over males. And also they found that these males tend to do poorly in school and had that bad rep for lack of better description. Pan ETL 2019 found that in Taiwan students, grades 4 through 12, there was a 19 to 20% prevalence, slightly higher than that in Wang ETL 2014, but confirming that it affects a good majority of some populations. I would assume that in America it is similar or higher, but that is not scientifically backed up, so take that with a grain of salt. I really could not find much sound good research on the prevalence of cyber relationship addiction or compulsive online information seeking. However, the trends show from the other three subtypes that depending on demographics, the prevalence can really vary. And Chang and Lee, 2014, also studied the prevalence of internet addiction. They conducted a meta-analysis, which is looking at hundreds of different research findings and averaging the results out, to put it in simple terms. And what they found was that there was a worldwide prevalence estimate of about 6%. The highest prevalence they found was in the Middle East at nearly 11%, and the lowest in the Western and Northern Europe at about 2.6%. They found that prevalence was higher for those nations with greater traffic time, pollution, and general dissatisfaction with life. And general dissatisfaction of life really correlated with internet addiction. And Chang and Lee, 2014, as I addressed earlier, explained that there are 5 subtypes most commonly seen because people usually get addicted to one application that results in the excessive usage. However, this prevalence of this meta-analysis does not count out addiction of the internet as a whole. It is accounting for both, but most of that 6% is addicts on the internet rather than addicts of the internet. And looking at online gaming addiction, we learned that some adolescents and 4th to 12th grade Asian students, that there was a 50 to 20% prevalence rate estimate, which is much, much higher than that 6%. Well, kids and adolescents are much more likely to be problematically playing online games, whereas you see older adults have a greater gambling prevalence rate than young kids. So it all evens out to that 6% average worldwide. Also, different subtypes, and depending on if you are looking at addiction on or addiction of, varies. And so it all evens out to that 6%. And from all of this, that we learn that internet addiction does indeed have research that supports that it is real. Most research leans towards addicts on the internet rather than addicts of. However, both are being considered internet addiction in research. I would argue that addicts on the internet isn't really internet addiction because they are addicted to something else, just using the internet as a medium, but addicts of the internet, that potential small population, if it truly is a thing, as research is showing, is internet addiction. We learn that prevalence rates vary widely across culture and demographics, like age and gender. We also learn that depending on if you're an addict on or of the internet, it affects the prevalence. After doing this research, I think that both sides of the controversial argument are true, that both sides do exist, one is just more prevalent than the other. And one last thing that I'd like to add is that, you know, back to when I was talking about my professor's lecture, where this background knowledge started, and how people fear that we're always on the internet all the time, and that's what internet addiction is, no. And I was honestly genuinely curious about how much time people around me were spending on the internet doing certain things. And some of my friends were spending 6 hours a day on social media. And this might be exaggerated because of quarantine and they're not working as much or anything like that. But just because they're spending 6 hours a day on social media or on the internet does not mean that they're addicted. And so I followed up with these certain people who had these extreme numbers of hours based on the screen time on their iPhone, on certain applications, or on their phone in general. And none of them reported feeling any distress or concern about getting off the internet or anything unusual when they're not on it or need to be on it. And just genuinely, it's just part of their life and what they're doing and where our life is at right now. And so it's important not to confuse that and our usage with internet addiction, because what I just described and explained to you with the research is internet addiction, but our fears of being on the internet too much, and where this background knowledge started with how we're spending a lot of time on the internet and that's our main focus. Just like at one point in time, television, reading novels, playing chess, listening to the radio, and reading the newspaper once were, is not internet addiction. Thank you for watching.